Today we're going to unbox the ROG Strix Z790-I and go over some of the basic features, followed by CPU, CPU frame, water block, and RAM installation. Inside the box we have the ROG keychain, the USB 2.0 header splitter, SATA cables, Wi-Fi antenna, zip ties, extra M.2 thermal pad, M.2 pedestal, power and reset button extension, the Strix Hive, we'll get into this in a bit, the ROG FPS2 card with two USB 2.0 header ports, power and reset button pins, two SATA ports, alteration mode for the PCI slot, CPU overvolt for extreme overclocking and a temp sensor pin. It wouldn't be complete without the manual, Hive instructions, stickers, and Asus web storage information sheet. The ROG Strix Hive is an awesome addition to this board and features a really smooth volume knob. This is a BIOS flashback button. It's the simplest and safest way to update the BIOS. All you have to do is plug in your USB stick and press this button. Updates can even be performed without having memory or a CPU installed. You can enable AI overclocking by pressing this button. Changes will be applied the next time your system restarts. This is the flex key button. It's really cool. It defaults to resetting the system, but it can be changed for other quick access features like activating safe boot or turning on and off the LEDs, which can be real convenient if you sleep with a computer in your room. These LEDs are a real convenient feature. They indicate power status or issues with CPU, memory, graphics card, or boot device. On this side, you'll find a USB-C and the BIOS flashback port. Lastly, we got microphone, headphone, and this port is specifically for Hive connection to the computer. Did I mention it has a magnetic base? Could be convenient for those with a metal desk. Moving on to the motherboard, we have the 8-pin CPU power connector. Three fan header ports back here, one CPU, one AIO, and chassis. Then the 24-pin motherboard power connector. Two dual-channel DIMM slots supporting up to 64 gigabytes of DDR5 7600 MHz RAM. One USB 3.2 Gen 1 header, one USB 3.2 Gen 2 header. Below that, there's two what appears to be USB-C connectors for the FPS2 card. As for CPU cooler compatibility, this motherboard is slotted for both 1200 and 1700 retention plates. Thanks, Asus. Moving along, we have a 3-pin and 4-pin RBG header. Then we have the PCI 5.0 slot. Now let's take a look at the M.2 tower. It's real impressive how there's a thermal pad on both sides of the first M.2 slot. This slot supports PCI 5.0. The second slot supports PCI 4.0 and routes through the chipset, which is right below this slot. The intake fan here is to keep the chipset nice and cool. Here's where that chipset fan intake is. Next to it, you'll find the VRM cooling array intake. For connectivity, we've got two USB 2.0 ports, HDMI, Thunderbolt 4 USB-C, USB 3.2 Gen 1 2.5 gig Ethernet port, Thunderbolt 4 USB-C, USB-C 3.2 Gen 2, three USB 3.2 Gen 2s, one is for the Hive, Wi-Fi 6E, and a CMOS clear button. Now for the CPU and CPU frame installation. We will be installing this 13900KF. But first, let's install this CPU contact frame and talk about it. So this ILM that I'm removing puts unnecessary pressure on the middle of the CPU that causes the top to bend or warp. This creates an uneven mounting surface for the CPU cooler. Intel insists the deflection isn't a problem. Where it isn't technically a problem, the CPU will run cooler with these installed. For Intel, this is only applicable to the LGA 1700 12 and 13th gen CPUs. It's extremely important to install these screws evenly in a crisscross pattern. And when I say evenly, don't tighten one side down super tight and then move on to the next. You don't want it to put unnecessary pressure on one corner of the CPU. Most of all, just follow the instructions for the CPU frame that you'll be installing, as different manufacturers may vary. As for RAM, we're using 64 gigabytes of DDR5 6400 G.skill Triton Z5 CL32 RAM. If you don't know what CL32 means or how that's relevant, it's definitely something to consider for performance when purchasing RAM. Basically, the lower the number at a higher megahertz means it's going to be faster, but there's much more to that than we're going to get into today. If you'd like to know more about it, do a web search, or let me know in the comments below if that's something you'd be interested in me doing a deep dive on. For this build, we're using Cryonaut Extreme by Thermal Grizzly. We'll need all the performance that we can get out of a thermal paste. This is one of the best rated and tested on the market. After purchasing, make sure that this seal is on the front of the packaging and go to their website and punch in the certificate of origin. You'd be surprised on how many knockoffs are out there. As for applying, I really like this wide tip they add to the kit. It helps ensure even application. Although it looks like I put a lot on here, it was just a thin coat and that's all that's really required. As for water block installation, it's equally important to install the thumb screws evenly in a crisscross pattern, just tightening a little bit at a time. This motherboard has a lot of great things to offer, but let's cover a few things that I don't like about it. The FPS panel. For one, it only has two SATA ports, where a lot of other ITX boards offer four. In addition to that, I think we're going to have some clearance issues with the ITX case, so this motherboard may not work out in that case if you're looking to expand with some SATA hard drives. Lastly, the Hive. I love the Hive. I've been using it for a couple weeks now, but I still wish there were audio ports on the back of the motherboard. That way you have a couple different options. And that's about it. Other than that, it's a great board. And there we have it, running on our test bench. Next week, we're going to test this system out with some benchmarks, games, and might do a little bit of overclocking, we'll see. Then we'll be testing thermals and performance with stress test, benchmarks, gaming, and then I have my personal computer on a test bench over here. We're going to swap graphic cards out and see how much of a difference in game performance and FPS there is between a 5900X and a 13900KF. We hope to see you there. Until then, please like and subscribe, and we'll see you next time.